Good afternoon, everyone. How are you doing? Hope you're fine. Yeah, it's your girl, Cecilia Karanja. Cecilia Karanja is the founder of Fertility Kenya. Fertility Kenya deals with persons struggling with infertility. And last time we had a discussion, we said that I'm going to be going around the country talking to doctors who are doing IVF procedures so that we can have variety. Yeah, so that we can have a taste of different doctors. Maybe we don't have the, so that we can also have the information that we need. There are so many people who don't know that there are other IVF centers. People just think of like one or two. So we want to have a taste of different doctors. So we are here today at Myra Fertility Clinic. We shall be talking to Dr. Sarita. Every one of you, I know most of you know Dr. Sarita, and she will be telling us what she does and all about IVF procedures and the ICSI and IUI, so that we can know if it's what we know or it's something different, and then we can be also know where she is located, so that we can be able to also come and get treated for infertility. So help me welcome Dr. Sarita. Dr. Sarita, how are you?
Good to have you here.
Thank you so much.
My pleasure.
Yeah, so we are here. Thank you for just giving us a warm welcome. We are so grateful. Thank you even for agreeing to have an interview with us. So we're just here, we just wanted you to talk about yourself and what you do.
Yes. So, yeah, so you can have a brief introduction on this. I'm Dr. Sarita. Mm-hmm. I am an MD obstetrician and then specialized in IVF and endoscopy. So I did my graduation and post-graduation from India, from one of the largest hospitals in Asia, which is BJ Medical College, Ahmedabad, which is in Gujarat. It's the land of our Prime Minister Modi. So I did everything from there. Mm-hmm. And after that, I moved to Delhi, again in a teaching hospital for 3 years. And then I went on to do my master's in IVF. And that was from Spain. And I've also done some fellowships from Cleveland Clinic as well as Germany, which are supposed to be the best institutes in the world.
Wow, Dr. Sarita. All that in your head?
Yeah. And then, yeah, I'm here to, you know, what I have learned to, you know, give it to the people and
give
help
it to the
them.
People.
Yeah.
And thank you so much for even taking the opportunity to come to our country to bring your expertise here.
Yeah.
So let's just go directly to what we've come to do is let's talk about IVF. In your own term, what do you understand IVF is?
See, IVF, what it stands for, I is in vitro fertilization, meaning normally egg gets fertilized by the sperm inside the body. Mm-hmm. But there might be some problems in a female or a male that they are not able to get fertilized inside the body. So we have to fertilize them outside the body, in vitro. That is called in vitro. Mm. So to explain to the people in simple terms, I will just give you a little brief. So that's the reproductive system of a female. This is the uterus. Mm-hmm. Then you have two tubes and you have the ovaries. So normally every female will make one egg from either of the ovary, which gets ready around mid-cycle. Mm-hmm. And once the egg is ready, it comes out and the tubes will pick it up and the egg has to go inside the tube. Yes. So once the egg is here, it is fertilizable for 24 hours. Mm-hmm. The lifespan of the egg is shorter as compared to the sperms. Mm-hmm. The sperms can remain alive for as many as 3 days. Mm-hmm. So once the egg is here, and a couple has intercourse, the sperms will move up and they will go into the tube and the fertilization happens here, and that is how the pregnancy forms. And from here, the fertilized embryo starts growing. Ultimately, it settles in the uterus and grows here. So there can be many issues during this normal procedure. So one is either a female is not making good egg,
yeah,
and also with the age, you know, the number of eggs starts going down, as well as the quality. So one issue could be that. The other could be there could be some problem with the tubes. So if the tubes are blocked, obviously the egg cannot enter and the egg gets fertilized only in the tube. Otherwise, it will go waste. So in Kenya especially, I've seen there are a lot of tubal problems. It could be because of the pelvic infections or any kind of infections which can block the tube. So if the tubes are blocked, there's no way a woman can have a normal pregnancy. She has to go through IVF. The other important thing is the sperm count. So we see even, I would say, 40 to 50% of the problems are because of men, that the sperm, either the counts are low or the motility is less, so that the sperms are not able to reach the egg, or there is abnormal morphology. And then in Africa region especially, you know, the fibroids are quite common. So per se, fibroids, it's not that always a fibroids will lead to infertility. If they are in the wall, if they are outside, then obviously they don't cause any problems. But if there is some fibroid which is occupying the space where the baby has to grow, that can cause problems. So in those cases, the fibroids have to be removed. You have to make a space for the embryo to grow, and then we proceed. So there can be a lot of issues actually which we need to look at. So this is how a normal pregnancy forms.
Yes.
Not talking about IVF. So basically our main motive is that the egg and the sperm have to get fertilized. So in IVF, what we do is we give injections to a woman so that the number of eggs, say there are five eggs here, five eggs here, they all get stimulated. And we can monitor them on the ultrasound. And once the eggs are ready, we go through the vagina inside the ovary through a needle, and we take the eggs out. And once we have the eggs, the same day the man is asked to give the sperm samples. And this is how we go through the vagina, go inside the egg, and the egg is taken out. And then under a special microscope, a sperm is picked up and it is injected into the egg. So that is what is ICSI. ICSI is intracytoplasmic sperm injection. So the sperm, we make sure that the sperm is injected inside the egg. So the egg is fertilized. And once it is fertilized, it starts growing like this. And usually we pick up two or three embryos on day three. Like these are the embryos. They are picked up and they are put back into the uterus. So we bypass the tubes. So that is what is IVF.
What I've never understood, Daktari, is now when once you get inside with a needle, do you pierce, go to, what do you pierce to
we
go
pierce
to
pierce the vagina? So obviously if somebody is even poking a needle, it's going to be painful. So it is done under a short anesthesia. A woman is put to sleep. About 15-20 minutes, I would say. Yeah, we have to go on this side and then we have to pick the eggs from this side. So
what do you pierce here to get into the
There's a needle. There's a needle which goes.
So you how do you get to this point?
See, when a woman is relaxed under the anesthesia, the vagina is very flexible. We can push the probe and we can be very close to the ovary so that there's nothing in between. When a person is relaxed. Not when a person is fully awake.
Because fully awake, of course, you feel pain.
It makes everything tight and, you know, you can't reach there.
Yeah,
so it has to be done under anesthesia. It's a short anesthesia.
And then when you get here, what, like I would imagine there are millions and millions or thousands and thousands of eggs. I don't know how many they we normally carry in our lifetime. But maybe you could give us a brief of it. And then how do you get to know that you've not taken everything, you know? And you have like just taken what you want.
So when a woman is born, there are more than 100,000 eggs. But it's not that they all will ovulate. So in the whole reproductive life of a woman, she ovulates approximately 400 times. So meaning there are 400 eggs which will be ovulated and which can be fertilized. So every cycle, a woman produces one egg. If it is not fertilized, it goes waste. So that is the number. And every cycle, a new crop of eggs comes up. So like in one cycle, there might be 5 or 7 eggs this side, 5 or 7 eggs this side.
Mm-hmm.
So anything more than 10, those eggs which will come up in that cycle, we can make out on the ultrasound.
Mm-hmm.
And that is why we say on 2nd or 3rd day, we can do the antral follicle count, which is called AFC.
Mm-hmm.
Meaning, if there are more than 10 eggs in that cycle, she has a good fertility reserve.
Mm-hmm.
And in that cycle, if we give her the injections, those 10 eggs will come up.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not that once we have taken out the eggs, all eggs are finished.
Mm.
It's a particular set of eggs that is going to come up in that cycle.
Okay.
So naturally, only one will come up and the rest will disintegrate.
Mm-hmm.
They'll go atresia.
Mm-hmm.
But in IVF, we give the injection so that all those eggs in that particular cycle, they come up. So suppose in one cycle, I have taken out 10 eggs. In next cycle, again, a new crop of 10 eggs will come up. So if we give them the injections,
mm-hmm.
we can take out more eggs.
Mm-hmm.
So that is what happens, you know, nowadays in girls who are postponing pregnancy because of career or late marriage.
Mm.
We suggest that if a woman has not got married by the age of 32, 33, it's always a good idea to preserve your eggs.
Yes.
So not maybe, sometimes you have to do 2 stimulations
mm.
in 2 cycles.
Mm.
We stimulate, we take out the eggs, we freeze them. And then another, after a gap of 1 or 2 months, we can stimulate them again
mm-hmm.
and take out more.
Mm-hmm.
So those eggs can be frozen for many number of years.
Okay.
Say she gets married at the age of 40 and she froze her eggs at 33.
Mm.
So those eggs are younger eggs.
Yeah, they're younger eggs.
And the chances of pregnancy are very good, mm. even at that age.
Okay.
So the IVF results are mainly dependent on the
mm-hmm.
age of the eggs.
Okay. Mm. So, Dr. once you remove these eggs, you put them here. So how do you determine that this is a good egg, this is a bad egg, and at what point do you fertilize for them to become embryos? Maybe you could explain to us that now that we are here, just give us the information. Once you have removed them from us, how many growth, maybe, depending on someone, maybe some can grow 20, some can grow 30, I've had,
yeah.
some have grown up to 30, is it whatever, what is it? And now there's some who remove one.
Yeah.
So maybe give us that before now we go to, now you have removed and what happens with that?
Yeah, see, so the number of eggs actually depends upon the age. The younger girls, they are most fertile, so they will have more number of eggs. And then in some patients like PCO patients, the polycystic ovarian disease patients, they also have too many eggs. But in those patients, because of the hormonal imbalance, the quality of eggs might not be that good. And so the percentage of fertilization in PCO patients is not very good.
Mm-hmm.
But generally, otherwise, if there is no PCO and a woman is young,
mm-hmm.
the chances of fertilization is close to 70-80%. Meaning if I have removed 10 eggs, I expect 7-8 good embryos if the other factors are normal. So that happens in the younger age group. But as you know, as the woman grows, her number of eggs starts going down.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody is born with certain set of eggs. There's mm-hmm. no way you can put the eggs back into the ovaries.
Yeah.
So if we look at the older woman, say 38, 39, 40, they might have few eggs, maybe 2, 3, or 4 eggs.
Mm.
And they are older. So their fertility reserve, which we can see by the ultrasound, and also there is a blood test known as anti-Müllerian hormone,
yeah.
AMH.
Mm.
So if the AMH is low, then it means the quality of eggs is also not very good, as along with the number. So in those patients, the fertilization rates are also not that good. So out of 5 eggs, I might get 1 or 2 embryos.
Mm-hmm.
So it all is dependent on the age of the woman. Age is the most important factor. Most important factor.
Okay. Now you have removed the eggs from us. You have put it here on the table. I will say in the table. What happens now?
Yeah. So once I have the eggs, see, they are put in certain media,
mm.
which has to be exactly which is in our body.
Mm.
Otherwise, they won't survive.
Yeah.
So they have to be at a particular pH. They have to be at a particular 37 degrees temperature.
Mm-hmm.
And to provide that, we have incubators which maintain all that.
Mm.
Now, once we have the eggs, they are put in the incubators. And after 2 hours, the embryologist will clean them to see whether they are mature or not mature, because sometimes some of the eggs might not have attained complete maturity, which we call M2 eggs. M2 eggs are the ones which are completely mature, and they are the ones which will be injected, which are fertilized. So once we have the eggs, we ask the man to give a semen sample by masturbation.
Yeah.
And then the semen sample is washed, the good sperms are separated, and then, so there are two methods. One is IVF, in which the sperm is not injected into each egg. The eggs are kept in one dish, and the sperms are also kept alongside, so they'll fertilize themselves outside the body.
That is IVF.
That is IVF.
Yes.
Which obviously, you know, we don't know whether all the eggs will be fertilized or not fertilized. So the results of fertilization are less. So to overcome this, nowadays what we do is we do the ICSI. But ICSI involves a expensive machine plus an expertise.
To do that,
you should have the good embryologist who can do the ICSI, in which you pick up one sperm. One sperm is picked up, one they hold one egg, and then they inject it inside.
Okay.
So that is what is ICSI. And once they are fertilized, then again, they, you know, the dish is marked by number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, like that. And this whole dish goes in the incubator for them to grow.
Yes.
You get it?
Mm-hmm.
So in the incubator, the same things are maintained as they would grow inside the body. That is why, you know, the IVF becomes expensive. Because to get all those things in a lab outside the body, with the same kind of media, with the same temperature, pH, and everything has to be set to grow them outside the body. So once they are inside, we usually take them out after 24 hours to see how many eggs have fertilized. So we will, if they are fertilized, we'll see 2 cells. And then we let them, then we don't do anything. We let them grow. On day 2, 2 cells will multiply into 4 or 6 cells. And on day 3, they will multiply into maybe 8, 16 cells. And then if we can see the cells are equal size, and they're very clear, there is no fragmentation, it means they are good embryos.
Yeah.
And then we pick up, say there are 10 embryos, so obviously we can't transfer all of them.
The 10 of them.
So we usually transfer 2 good embryos,
hoping
that at least one will stick and grow. So in a younger age group...
Dr. Sarita, sorry for interrupting you. How do you know that this is a good embryo? Is there, you check it on microscopy?
Yeah.
You just check and see, this egg is better than this one with your own
eye. No. That's what I said. See, once they are fertilized, maybe there should be a picture here. See, like this. So, once they are fertilized, you can see, you can make out the cells.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
This is like 4 cell. So if the cells are equal, and there is no ragged margins, which we call fragmentation, and they're very clear, equal size, they are supposed to be the good embryos. And then there are different other criteria, and once the embryo grows, if you have good embryos and if you have adequate number, we allow them to go up to day 5 also. So the embryos which have grown outside the body up to day 5, it means they have a capability to grow even inside.
Yeah.
So if you have enough embryos, we can take them up to day 5, which is called blastocyst. And then we select the best ones and transfer.
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay. That is good. Now you have transferred.
Yeah.
What happens?
So now, once the embryos are pushed into the uterus, so again, that is done under ultrasound. Somebody will hold the ultrasound. I'll push my catheter.
Am I under anesthesia or is it just normal?
No, it's without anesthesia. It's a very thin plastic catheter which goes inside, and we can see where is it going, and we place the embryos.
Okay,
you can just see the dot on the ultrasound.
Okay.
That they have gone at the right place.
Okay.
And once Because in IVF, a woman has been given a lot of medication, so we put them on the support medications so that the embryos which have been transferred, they can implant and they can grow. And after 2 weeks, we do the blood test. And then we get to know whether she has got pregnant or not.
Okay. In your case, Dr. Sarita, do you allow people to work after the transfer, or what do you advise people to do immediately after the transfer?
See, generally, we say that not a complete bed rest, but a restricted activity is advisable. So they should avoid any kind of exertion or any jerky traveling.
Mm-hmm.
And we tell them to abstain from sex for 2 days,
mm-hmm.
because that can induce contractions.
For 2 days only?
Yeah, for 2 days.
So after that, you can have sex?
Yeah.
Oh,
because, it is only in the 48 hours that the embryo will get implanted. Once it has implanted, then it will grow.
It's so only in 48 hours?
48 hours, 2 days
only. 2 days only?
Yeah.
That the embryo will attach?
Yeah. There's a window of implantation.
Yes.
And it will implant if it has to implant.
It has to implant. If it has not implanted, it will not implant.
It will not implant, yeah.
Okay.
So 2 days of rest is advisable. And immediately after the transfer, we say 2 hours is more than enough.
Mm-hmm.
Then she can get up, be on her normal, and she can do the regular activities.
You can go back to work?
Preferably, no. Because, you know, when you are at work, you are running around and there's a lot of stress. Yeah. So it's always better to take just 2 days. That is what I advise, and a lot of people have advised that.
Mm-hmm.
So that is advisable.
Okay.
After 2 days, she can be normal. She can do what she wants.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, no jerky traveling till you get the pregnancy test. You have to avoid that.
Okay. Dr. Why do we get spotting during our 14 days wait? Why do patients at time get some spotting?
At the time of ovulation, you mean?
No. You see, like, you have transferred us the embryos.
Mm-hmm.
Eh? Then you've told us to go and wait for 14 days.
Mm.
Between the 14 days, there are people who say that they spot.
Mm-hmm.
Why would that happen?
See, it's sometimes, you know, some people can have implantation bleeding.
Mm-hmm.
When the embryo has implanted and there is time after 14 days, even if the embryo has implanted, the uterus lining is very thick. And that will be the time of your regular cycle.
Mm-hmm.
So some people can have little spotting.
Mm-hmm.
In spite of having spotting, the pregnancy can grow.
Mm-hmm.
It's not that she's aborting.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And also, if some people have been put on the support medication.
Yes.
And if by any chance, if they have missed or they have stopped,
mm-hmm.
then also you can have a withdrawal bleeding.
Okay.
So it is advisable, unless your doctor says, do not stop the medication,
mm-hmm.
because you are on support medication like progesterone, gel,
mm-hmm.
or any other medication that you are taking.
Mm-hmm.
So you should, even if you have done the test, you should continue taking your medication unless advised by the doctor.
Okay. Now it takes me now to like, I need to understand from the time I get into the door, what happens to me when I come to you.
Mm-hmm.
Just briefly tell us, once you get here, do I need to pay for consultation or registry? What else do I need to do? How much is the procedure? Then just take me through, do I need to take medication? After medication, what time do I come for the procedure?
Yeah, let me get the file, one
mm-hmm.
file, new patient file.
Okay.
So as soon as the patient comes,
mm-hmm.
she will be given a file in which
of course, once they get in, they are welcomed.
Yeah.
They feel at home.
Yeah.
Thank you.
My secretary will ask them, okay, welcome, and then she will give them a new file
mm-hmm.
in which patient has to fill the their names,
mm-hmm.
age, the husband's name, age, what's the occupation,
mm-hmm.
how long they've been married,
yes.
and what is the sexual history, whether they are staying together all the time, or sometimes, you know, the husband and wife, they are working in different cities, how often they meet. So all these things, they are important.
Mm-hmm.
And then also we ask about their any previous history of pregnancy, like she has any pregnancy or she has ever miscarried. If she has delivered, it was a normal delivery or a cesarean delivery.
Mm-hmm.
or if she has miscarriage, whether the cleaning was done or not, and then any other family history of diabetes, high blood pressure, any cancers, any surgeries done in the past,
mm-hmm.
any treatments she has gone through,
mm-hmm.
how are her cycles, whether they're regular, irregular, all those things. Because all those things are important to, you know, look at her fertility reserve as well as the other factors.
Okay.
And whatever investigations have been done, we go through it, especially the thyroid, prolactin, and the estrogen, progesterone, FSH, etc.
Mm.
A lot of people come with AMH also. Now they know that AMH is a fertility reserve marker.
Mm-hmm.
So we note down all that in the file. And then based on those results, we decide whether we have to start the investigations if they are too old. And so for a female, we advise them these tests.
Mm-hmm.
These are marked here.
Mm-hmm.
So these are the tests for the female we usually advise. The thyroid, the hormones, the prolactin. Routine sugar,
okay.
CBC, and the viral markers,
mm-hmm.
and one ultrasound I prefer to do myself.
Mm,
to
the
look
ultrasound,
at the,
so
look
that
at
you're
the,
able to know if the uterus is
okay,
okay or no.
And the ovaries, how many eggs are there.
Mm.
And for the man, we ask them to give a semen sample after 3 days of abstinence,
mm-hmm.
So that we can know about the sperms and the routine viral markers.
Okay.
So these are a must for both the partners.
Dr. Sarita, once a patient walk in, what happens? I just wanted to have a brief of like from the time they get in to the time they do the procedure in a brief.
So once the patient comes in,
mm-hmm.
They are given this paper,
mm-hmm.
which is about a new patient file. It records all the details about the patient's name, where they live, when did they visit us first, their email address, the phone number, so that, you know, we can communicate in future.
Mm-hmm.
The husband's name, age, what's the occupation, because these are important things to find out if there's any issue anywhere.
Mm-hmm.
Their sexual history, and they've been married for how long, whether they have used any contraception, they know the fertile period or not. And then what about her cycles, whether they are regular, when was the last cycle,
mm-hmm.
any previous pregnancy histories or any miscarriages, and if she has any history of family history of diabetes, high blood pressure, any other disease,
mm-hmm.
and their height, weight, blood pressure, etc., everything is recorded.
Mm-hmm.
And the investigations which they have done, the any hormone tests which they have done, the AMH especially, which is the fertility reserve marker,
mm.
the any tube testing if it has been done in the past,
yeah.
the ultrasound, and then there are some specialized tests which are required for patients who have had repeated miscarriages,
mm.
or repeated IVF failures,
mm.
any surgery, laparoscopy, hysteroscopy they have done, so everything is recorded. And then comes the husband part. So husband might have done the semen test. And so we look at the previous semen reports. And if required, some men come with low sperm counts or no sperms, then we advise them to go for the hormonal profile again.
Mm-hmm.
And the routine investigations for the male and female are suggested. And and then we mark like which are the factors which are responsible in the female, or it's a male factor, there's PCOD, or it is a tubal factor, or the eggs are less, whatever is there, we just mark that.
Mm-hmm.
And then I write down the treatment plan.
Okay.
That for this patient,
they need this.
This one, yeah.
Okay.
And these are the tests which are required,
mm-hmm.
for the female,
mm-hmm.
the hormone test,
mm-hmm.
and the viral markers, the ultrasound I do myself,
mm-hmm.
to check the uterus and ovaries.
Mm-hmm.
For the male, he's asked to give a semen sample after 3 days of abstinence,
mm-hmm.
as well as the viral markers. So these are the basic things which are required for a male and female.
Okay, what I wanted to know, like how much will they spend for the test?
Approximately 15,000 to 18,000.
Okay, for the lady?
For the both.
Both of them.
Both of
15
them.
15 to 20,000.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Next, once you've confirmed they're okay for the procedure, what happens?
So now I take them for ultrasound and I look at the uterus and the ovaries and we see if the eggs are okay or not. And I explain them that if the tubes are fine, if they have checked that the tubes are okay, the patient is young and the semen count is maybe, you know, not very good, then we can advise them to go for a little cheaper option, which is intrauterine insemination, because it's not very expensive and we can time exactly when the egg is ready and we can prepare the sperm and we can put the semen sample inside.
Intrauterine, you mean IUI?
IUI.
Okay.
Yeah. So the IUI is advised to people who are younger, who have good eggs.
The tubes are open. The sperm might not be okay.
They might be, see, the normal count is up to 15 million.
Mm.
Some people have between 10 and 15 and 5 and 15.
Mm.
Then we can try IUI. But if it is less than 5, then obviously the IUI results are not very good. Then they have to go for IVF.
So for IUI, how much do you charge for IUI?
I charge approximately 55,000. Which includes the tablets, the 6 days of injection, the semen preparation, the insemination, and all the ultrasounds, because I will be calling them at least 3 to 4 times to see how the eggs are growing.
Okay.
So it includes everything for one cycle.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Now we go. We found somebody needs IVF. What happened?
Yeah. So for IVF, see, now suppose a woman is aged. The number of eggs is not good, AMH is low. So then, you know, we can't waste so much time because their egg reserve is limited. Say the sperm count is less, or they have already tried 3-4 cycles of IUI. In spite of everything normal, it has not worked. Then it is the time to move to IVF. The IVF procedure we have discussed already. So why we say IVF is the last resort is because it's expensive.
Yeah, it is.
And then in an older woman especially, we can't waste so much time. Otherwise, they will not be left with any eggs. And there comes a time that there are no eggs actually. And then obviously, we have to go for the donor eggs. We don't want to go that way. But if there is no option, we have to. That's the only thing. So in IVF, as I said, we have to first grow the eggs. So the injections, the hormonal injections which are given, they are expensive.
So once they do the test, Daktari, you start them on medication or immediately you tell them to come after periods or whatever?
Yeah, so the whether it's the IUI or the IVF, the treatment starts from the second or third day of the periods. From second or third day, we put them on the injections. I do the scan first.
Let me get something, Dr. Once I come in here,
yeah,
you have done all the tests, I'm ready for IVF. So you've confirmed I'm ready for IVF.
Yeah.
So what happens from there? You tell me to go, I come back on the second day. Okay.
Once you come on the second day of the period, still I will do the scan.
Yes.
Before I start the injection, because I need to rule out, sometimes there can be cysts which can appear anytime.
True.
So I need to do the scan, confirm everything is okay. Then I write down the injections. The injections are the combination of FSH, LH, which are the hormones. And they are given in a slightly higher dose so that the eggs which are there, they can grow.
Yeah.
Now the injections cost is approximately 80,000 to 100,000. Because once we start the injections, they have to be given every day for 10 days.
For 10 days.
10 or 11 days, depending on how the eggs are growing. And for the injections, the first dose, my nurse gives them here. And we tell them, because some of the injections are easy to be taken, which are given in the fat, which a person can do themselves if they're not too scared of the injections.
Yeah.
So we tell them either you can come here every day to take the
injections.
Or if they can take, they can carry with themselves and they take the injections. And on 5th day of the injections, I check them again
for another scan. So the first scan is on the second day of the period.
Yeah.
The
The second scan is on the fifth day of the injections.
Okay.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Fifth day of the injections.
Mm-hmm.
And from that, we add one more injection mm-hmm. to prevent the rupture of the eggs.
Mm-hmm.
And then I call them usually on the eighth day of the injections. So there are about 3 or 4 scans which are done to exactly regulate that the eggs are growing well.
On the eighth day
of the injections.
There's another scan.
Yeah.
The third scan.
And then finally on 10th or 11th day of the injections, we do the final scan.
Mm-hmm.
Usually by 10th or 11th day, the eggs are ready.
10th or 11th day.
Yeah.
Okay.
And that day we give them the trigger.
Mm-hmm.
And 35 hours after the trigger,
mm-hmm.
the eggs are picked up. So they are called into the lab, mm-hmm. the IVF lab,
yeah.
where the eggs are picked up.
Mm-hmm.
And the same day, the husband has to come to give the semen sample.
Mm-hmm.
And then we fertilize them.
Mm-hmm.
And depending on the uterus lining.
Yeah.
Because sometimes when the hormone injections are given,
mm-hmm.
then the uterus lining is sometimes not very good.
Mm-hmm.
So in those cases, we fertilize the eggs and we freeze them.
Mm-hmm.
But if the uterus lining is good, the hormone levels are okay,
mm-hmm.
then I do transfer.
Okay.
Yeah.
So we've said for the test is between 15 to 20,000. What about the procedure? How much?
IVF procedure costs about 450,000
mm-hmm.
and the injection cost is between 80 to 100,000.
The injections are on the side. Yeah. You have to pay for the injection. The yeah. procedure is 450.
Yeah. Okay. So approximately 500 to 550 is the mm-hmm. total cost for one cycle of IVF.
Okay. And then after you do the transfer, what happens? Here you have removed the eggs and you have fertilized and then you transfer.
Yeah.
Do we need to go home with the medication that we pay
yeah.
for?
Yeah.
We pay for the medication.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's about
for the
10-12,000. Not 10 much.
10-12,000.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Wow.
And we call them after 2 weeks.
Yes.
They do the blood test.
Yes.
To confirm whether they got pregnant or not.
Or not.
Mm-hmm.
The pregnancy test for the blood, of course.
The beta HCG test.
The beta HCG.
Yeah.
Then once they have been confirmed they are pregnant, do they continue with the medication or do they stop immediately?
No. See, IVF pregnancy is a very precious pregnancy.
Yeah.
And first 3 months, we do put them on medication which supports the pregnancy.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, you know, the chances of miscarriage are there. And obviously, when somebody has spent so much of money, so much of time and efforts, we want it to, you know, go smoothly.
Yeah.
So they have to be on the medication for first 3 months.
Mm-hmm.
And then after 3 months, once we have seen that the baby is growing well, heartbeat is there, and she is progressing well, then we slowly take them off, not all of a sudden.
Mm. Okay. So, okay, after they've been confirmed they're pregnant, you put them on other medication that costs roughly how much? And then how long are they going to take for the procedure, for the medication?
So I would say approximately I put them on the support medication, which might cost between 5,000 to 6,000 a week.
Okay.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Which continues up to at least 10 weeks.
Mm-hmm.
And once we confirm everything is okay, then we slowly withdraw the support medications also.
Okay. In this case, once they do the procedure, Dr. Ray, do you continue as their gynecologist or you ask them to go somewhere else?
Usually after 3 months, I tell them to go to their obstetrician.
Okay.
Because I generally deal with the IVF and the laparoscopies.
Okay.
I send them to the other doctors, who
yes.
either the doctors who have referred to me or they can choose their...
Wherever they
yeah.
want to go.
Yeah.
But you make sure that the babies are safe. Once you confirm they are safe, then now you can release
yeah.
them somewhere
yeah.
else.
Yeah.
Wow, that is nice, Doctor. Thank you, Dr. Sarita. That was powerful. You've given us... very good information that we really wanted to have. So maybe generally you can tell us about your success and how many IVF you've done. Not necessarily how many, like what is the success rate you would want to do. And maybe, yeah.
Yeah, so the success rate of, see, I've been doing IVF for last 15 years now.
Yes. Mm.
And I think I've treated, must have treated more than 5,000 patients.
Yeah.
And the success rates are generally between 50 to 60%.
50 to 60. Okay.
In younger age group.
Mm-hmm.
But if the patients are older,
mm-hmm.
say 40 plus, then the success rates are maximum 30 to 35%, not more than that.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, if 42, 43 age group woman comes, we see if we can try, we try with their own eggs.
Mm-hmm.
So in that age group, the success rates are only this. If they succeed with their eggs, fine.
Mm-hmm.
If they don't, then we have to move on to the donor eggs.
The donor eggs.
So the donor egg success is obviously good because the eggs are from a younger woman.
Very true. Yeah.
So in that, again, the success rates could be 70% or 80% donor
okay.
eggs.
Yeah. True.
Yeah.
So but the eggs are for younger
yeah,
person.
Yeah.
Okay. That is good. So give us like a closing remarks and where you're located and
yeah. So now I practice out of my clinic here at Third Parklands on in Doctors Park, fifth floor, which is just next to Aga Khan Hospital. So I do most of my work here and I'm usually available every day from 10 to 4. And yeah, if sometimes, you know, the working people, they want to come in the evening hours. So I do take their appointments by appointment only, but generally every day I'm here.
Yeah.
And usually the surgeries I perform early mornings from 8 o'clock onwards.
Mm-hmm.
And I do IVF, laparoscopies, hysteroscopies. Then there's one more thing which we didn't discuss was TESA for the azoospermic man. If we see that it is because of the obstruction, then we can directly take out the sperms from the testis, which is called TESA, testicular sperm aspiration.
Mm.
It is like same, on the IVF day when we take out the eggs from the female, the same day we do a small surgical procedure to take out the sperms, which can be used for the IVF. So all those things also I do, and the results have been quite satisfying. And
what is PESA?
PESA is again a form of TESA. It's from the epididymis, the percutaneous epididymal sperm aspiration. That is called PESA. So it's like TESA, but usually a lot of people perform TESA.
TESA.
Yeah.
Okay. Give us your contact, your Facebook page so that we can follow you. And maybe if you want to ask more questions that we've not answered here, people can call you.
Yeah, yeah, sure. So this is my number, 786-404972.
Repeat again.
It is 786-404972, Myra IVF Clinic. So that's my number. You can always WhatsApp me or email me. My email ID is drsarita2007@gmail.com. And my secretary's number, if by any chance, if I'm busy with the patient, I don't pick up the phone, you can always call my secretary, Nancy, at 786-656-236 for the appointments. And my website is www.drsaritasukhija.in. And you can even book the online appointment on that. I also take teleconsultations. If you can't visit personally, you can fix up a teleconsultation appointment. I can talk on phone, WhatsApp call, whatever is convenient. And after the first consultation, I mean, a lot of things we can be in touch on email or even WhatsApp. And you can just come here for the treatment only. And most of the things can be done online nowadays.
Okay. Thank you so much, Dr. Sarita.
Keep safe, all of you. These have been really hard times.
Yeah.
Corona times, no traveling, nowhere, nothing. So, yeah. But that's why I think online things have developed a lot.
Very true.
So, although there are some things, especially in medical field, we can't do online. But yeah, the things which can be done, we are always there.
Okay. Thank you very much, Dr. Terry. Before I forget, do you take walk-in clients? Do you do appointments?
Yeah.
We do.
10 to 4, if I'm here, anyone who comes, I will attend.
You'll attend to them. How much is the consultation?
Consultation is 3,000.
$3,000.
Very reasonable.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you very much, Dr. Terry.
We are so excited to have Dr. Sarita, who've given us a lot of information about IVF procedure. Now you know we can come to Myra Clinic just here in Third Parklands, just next to Aga Khan Hospital. You'll see Dr. Spark, fifth floor, then you will see Myra Clinic. So, Santi Sana Daktari, thank you for the information that you've given us. And I know, my people, you'll be coming. I've not done any negotiation for the consultation, but I know I'll do that and we will get it.
Yeah, thank you, Daktari. You're most welcome.
Thank you. I will come and we'll do that. And then my people can just be coming for free consultation.
Thank
you so much, my people. May God bless you. Keep safe, like Daktari is saying. Until next time, love you always.
Thank you.